AI is everywhere right now in early 2024, and it seems likely its reach and capability will keep growing. The goal of today is to give you a quick intro into the very basics of AI, so you have a better idea of how AI is working and maybe what's to come. We're not touching any technical math and programming, at least today, but you should be leaving with enough base knowledge as a jumping off point for you to learn about building systems like this. If you're instead someone who just wants to know a bit more about AI and how to use it, I think we got something for you too. As AI tools are becoming more prevalent and accessible, it's in your best interest to learn the fundamentals on how AI works. Oh, and by the way, I'm Victor. I've been working in this field for a while now. I recently started a role at Google collaborating with internal and external teams doing this AI thing. You can check out my GitHub if you're curious to learn more about me. So this video is actually a version of a talk I've given over the past year to 5th through 8th graders, think 10 to 14 year olds. And usually when I ask them what they think AI is, it's usually chatbots like ChatGPT. They also usually say robots, and sometimes someone throws out things like AI music and AI art generation. All of these are AI, and seems to match what the average person generally thinks of when they hear AI, which right now is generative AI, or also called GenAI. So let's get into this and discuss the basics of AIs. In short, almost all modern AI, the stuff people are mostly referring to today, is pretty much using something called machine learning, or also called ML. AI works, and what I really mean is how ML works, by using data to make better decisions. Note that when I say decisions, this can mean making predictions based on input data, such as guessing what the future stock price of a company will be. This can also mean a string of decisions that leads to something newly generated, such as a sentence or image never before said or created. I'd love to get into the gory details and nuance about this, but I'm trying to keep this video relatively short. Trust me when I say this easily could be an hour plus video and still only be scratching the surface. Perhaps for another time. Let's summarize all of the AI we care to talk about into three categories. First is supervised learning. Think of this as wanting an AI to give an answer predicted from some inputs. We can predict something like a number, how old we think this dog is, or predict what group an item belongs to. Is this a picture of a dog or cat? Supervised learning is used specifically when we have example answers to learn from. You can think of the data with answers coming from a teacher, and the AI tries to learn from these examples. Typically, we call these answers labels or targets. Next, we have unsupervised learning. This is different from supervised learning in that we don't have a teacher. The AI needs to figure things out all by itself without examples. Clustering is a common unsupervised learning task. Basically, the AI groups individuals based on their properties. For example, an AI using unsupervised learning could be tasked to group a set of bugs into similar groups, perhaps making smaller groups of bugs that are most similar to one another. Finally, we have reinforcement learning. This is basically the AI learning on their own with a teacher directly watching them. There's a defined reward and punishment given by the teacher for when the AI does the right or wrong thing. Sort of like supervised learning, but you don't start with examples. The AI just has to figure things out and see what reward it gets. For example, reinforcement learning can be used for an AI to learn how to keep a robot standing. We give rewards when the bot stays up and a punishment for when it falls down. It has to learn how to adjust the robot's stance depending on things like how the robot is currently standing, the kind of floor it's on, and anything adding an extra force, like a gentle or gusty wind. We can even have the AI learn how to handle an unexpected shove. The more environments it's exposed to, the more robust the AI will be in new situations. Right now, most AI is done through supervised learning and reinforcement learning, but unsupervised learning is typically folded in to get more examples with answers. Note the phrase learning is used frequently here. This is because the AI improves or learns iteratively to get better or more right answers. Let's take a look at this with an example with some cute little cats and dogs. We want to determine whether an animal is a cat or dog based on how loud and how big it is. This can be approached with supervised learning, so we'll need to start with some data that have labels, that is whether the animal is a cat or dog. We can take a few examples and represent them on a plot like this. Note we can see what the animals really are based on their little pictures. Our goal is to be able to draw some sort of barrier to separate the dogs from the cats. Here's an example of a simple line that separates the two groups. We can use this line by saying cats are on the left side and the dogs on the right side of the line. We could have also drawn this line to separate the cats and dogs. In fact, there are literally an infinite number of lines that we could have done. So the question becomes, which line is better? In machine learning, we usually have a training dataset that our AI learns from and a validation or test set to evaluate how well the AI does. Note I'm skipping a distinction here between the validation and test set for simplicity. But the key part is that these datasets help us evaluate the AI after learning happens. These six little animals represent our training set, since these are the data we use to figure out what kind of line to draw. But now we need some extra data to test what barrier version is better. This is usually referred to as evaluation. If we look at the first line, we see that although the training data, the original six animals, were separated well, one of the cats from the test set would be labeled improperly. That is, the cat is on the wrong side of the line. So we're 3 for 4 with this line on the test set. Let's check out the curvy second line. In this case, we actually have 3 errors from the test set. We can say from this evaluation that the first simpler line was the best line. Note we could have had other lines, like this one, that would correctly separate all the test data in the training data. You might be asking yourself now, so where's the AI? Well, in our example, the AI is the line. Or more accurately, we think of the AI learning how to draw better lines, which translates to being better at a particular task. In our case, how to determine a cat from a dog by the inputs of loudness and size. We typically call this AI learning process training. So let's go over what the full process looks like. We start with the AI making a guess on data inputs with answers known by the AI. This guess is frequently referred to as the model. Note that typically the AI and the model are referred to as the same thing. Then the model is evaluated and given a score that tells us how well the AI did. Then the AI takes the score and adjusts the model. Rinse and repeat a lot of times, and eventually the AI/model is pretty good at the task. Well, hopefully good at the task. And so you might be asking, how does the AI adjust its score? Well, that's where all the gooey technical stuff comes in, and we can just simply slap the word math as the explanation. If you're really curious about it, you can look up things like gradient descent, hill climbing, and genetic algorithms. You might also be asking, how do we make different lines? The short answer is there's a bunch of different methods. Right now, most AI models are some variants of neural networks. This is an example of a neural network representation. In short, just trust me that you can generate lines or other decisions from this. Again, this is where we can slap the word math on it and call it a day. Most popular generative AI today, like chatbots and AI art, use some variant of a neural network. This was a lot for just the basics, so we'll stop here for today. For now, remember that an AI learns from a set of given inputs and answers. So with these two pieces, it's possible to train an AI to do a whole bunch of tasks. Think about how we can use this process of training an AI with inputs and answers to instead generate something new. In the next video, we'll take a look at two GenAI examples that do exactly this and use what we learned about training AI to understand how they work. Thanks for watching, and I hope you stick around to catch the next video.